Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I'm going to present the topic of amniocentesis and chorionic villus sampling. This is in fact the GREAT top guideline number 8. It was published in June 2010, and no other guideline came after that. Okay, so we are going to discuss the important features in this guideline. So first of all, the aim of this guideline. How much percent of women are offered invasive prenatal diagnostic test? It is estimated that 5% of the pregnant population, approximately 30,000 women per annum in the UK, are offered the choice of invasive prenatal diagnostic test, most commonly amniocentesis or chorionic villus sampling. And the type of diagnostic test available and offered is likely to vary depending upon the timing of the initial screening test that is being performed. Okay, now at what age of gestation amniocentesis is performed? Amniocentesis is most commonly performed most common invasive prenatal diagnostic test undertaken in the UK, and most amniocentesis are performed to obtain amniotic fluid for karyotyping from 15 weeks onward. Okay, and amniocentesis, what is early amniocentesis? Amniocentesis which is performed before 15 completed weeks of gestation is referred to as early amniocentesis. And now we have to know that when is CVS performed. Chorionic villus sampling or CVS is usually performed between 11 and 13 plus 6 weeks of gestation and involves the aspiration or biopsy of placental villi. CVS can be performed either through transabdominal or transcervical approach. Now coming toward the rates of miscarriages, women should be informed that additional risk of miscarriage following amniocentesis is around 1%. Women should be informed that additional risk of miscarriage following CVS may be higher than that of amniocentesis carried out after 15 weeks of gestation. Okay, so with amniocentesis, if the risk is 1%, so with the CVS, the risk would be higher than 1%. Now, how much is the risk of bloodstain lichen? The bloodstain lichen risk is estimated to be about 0.5% overall. How much is the risk of post-amniocentesis pregnancy loss? A recent systematic review estimated total post-amniocentesis pregnancy loss to be about 1.9%, and practitioners should be aware of these issues, and if coating procedure related loss lower than 1%, they should carefully evaluate the adequacy of their own follow-up data. Okay, and there is also increasing evidence that operators who perform procedures frequently have lower miscarriage rates. So on individual basis, each operator should have their own follow-up plan. Okay, there are no published studies comparing CVS with no testing. Meta-analysis of all randomized control trial comparing CVS by any other route with the second trimester amniocentesis showed an excess pregnancy loss following CVS. Now, how much is the second trimester miscarriage rate? Okay, there was only one direct randomized comparison of transabdominal CVS with the second trimester amniocentesis reporting similar total pregnancy loss in the two sets, 6.3% compared with the 7%. Okay, so in the transabdominal CVS, if the risk is CV at 6.3, then in the second trimester amniocentesis, the risk would be 7%. Another question, at what gestation should amniocentesis and CVS be carried out? Amniocentesis should be performed after 15 weeks of gestation. What happens if amniocentesis is performed before 14 weeks? Amniocentesis before 14 weeks of gestation, which is called early amniocentesis, has a higher fetal loss rate and increased incidence of fetal telipes and respiratory morbidity compared with the other procedure. As CVS could not be performed before 10 weeks of gestation. Okay, now how much is the risk of each complication? Early amniocentesis is not a safe alternative to second trimester amniocentesis. Okay, early amniocentesis is not a safe alternative to second trimester amniocentesis because of increased pregnancy loss, which is 7.6% compared with the 5.9%. Okay, and early amniocentesis, which is performed in the first trimester, carry increased risk of telipes when compared with a CVS. Early amniocentesis is not recommended. Okay, should be performed after 15 weeks of gestation. Is there any association between CVS and other complication? Okay, so it's written that the association between CVS, oromandibular limb hypoplasia, and isolated limb disruption defects has been debated since the issue was first raised in 1991, when a cluster of 5 babies with the limb reduction defects was reported among the series of 289 women undergoing transabdominal CVS between 8 and 9 weeks. A subsequent analysis showed no difference in the rate of this abnormality compared with the population incidence, although the vast majority of procedures were performed after 10 weeks of gestation. Now the question arises, why is CVS technically difficult before 11 weeks? CVS before 11 weeks can be technically difficult to perform owing to smaller uterus and thinner placenta. Now what consent is required prior to performing amniocentesis or CVS? Written consent should be obtained prior to performing amniocentesis or CVS. It is good practice to obtain formal written consent for amniocentesis or CVS before the procedure. And practice should conform to the recommendation on the consent from General Medical Council and RCOG, and use of the Department of the Health Consent Form 3 is recommended. Written or oral information should include, first of all, the reason for offering invasive procedure. Secondly, explanation of the type of the cytogenetic results which will become available. And third, the process for any long-term sample storage and the quality control. So these are the three things. The reason for offering, explanation of the type of cytogenetic results which will become available, and the process for the long-term sample storage. These all should be explained in the consent form, and we should tell these things verbally. Now, what other information should be given? Information should also be provided in relation to national and locally estimated risk of procedure-related pregnancy loss, accuracy and limitation of particular laboratory tests being performed, with information noted on the culture failure rates and reported times, the method of communication of the results, indications for seeking medical advice following the test, and the need for anti-D post-procedure if woman is Rh negative. Now, what technique should be used to perform amniocentesis or CVS? Okay, first of all, the ultrasound guidance. The needle insertion during amniocentesis and transabdominal CVS should be carried out under simultaneous ultrasound visualization by practitioner performing the ultrasound guidance. Now, another important thing is the avoidance of the Transplacental passage of amniocentesis needles should be avoided unless it provides only safe access to an adequate pool of lycra. Okay, so first thing is ultrasound guidance. Secondly, we have to avoid invasion through placenta tissue. Third is about the maximum size of the needle. The maximum outer needle gauge of 0.9 mm, which is 20 gauge, should be used to perform amniocentesis. Now, competency. Is there any role of competency? Should the person who is performing the procedure be competent enough or not? Okay, so about this, it is written that clinicians should use the CVS technique with which they are competent, using local anesthesia for transabdominal CVS. Now, what is the importance of ultrasound guidance? Methods of amniocentesis have been variously described in literature. A blind procedure involving palpating the outline of uterus and inserting needle into selected spot is no longer an acceptable technique. And with ultrasound guidance, the content of the uterus, particularly the position of the placenta and umbilical cord insertion, are visualized prior to amniocentesis. Okay, and another thing is that continuous visualization of the needle with ultrasound reduces the blood stain from 2.4% to 0.8%, and there are cases report documenting the serious fetal trauma caused by amniocentesis needles. So it's very important to have ultrasound guided approach. Now, what is the percentage of the local anesthesia being used in the UK? A recent survey of the practice revealed that only 4% of specialists in the UK use the local anesthesia for amniocentesis, compared with 98% when transabdominal CVS is performed. Now, what is required for training and maintaining good practice in amniocentesis? Operator carrying out unsupervised amniocentesis and CVS should be trained to competencies expected of subspecialty training in the maternal and fetal medicine, the RCOG fetal medicine advanced training skill modules, and other international equivalents. Clinical skill models, assessment of interaction with the patient, and supervised procedures should be an integral part of the training. Competency should be maintained by carrying out at least 30 ultrasound guided invasive procedures per annum, and units and operator should carry out continuous audit of frequency of multiple insertion failure, bloody tabs, and post procedural losses. Very experienced operators, more than 100 per annum, may have higher success rate and lower procedure related loss rate. Occasional operator who perform a low number of procedure per annum have an increased rates of procedure related loss. And further opinion should be sought from more experienced operator if difficulties are anticipated or encountered. Now, expert opinion suggests that operator competence should be reviewed where loss rates appear high, and audit should certainly occur where they exceed 4 per 100 consecutive amniocentesis or 8 per 100 CVS. Okay, if there are fetal loss in 4 per 100 consecutive amniocentesis or 8 per 100 in case of the CVS, then the operator competence should be reviewed. Okay, and now coming to the other points, that what are the clinical consideration when performing amniocentesis or CVS for multiple pregnancy. It is recommended that in case of the multiple pregnancy, a CVS or amniocentesis is performed by a specialist who has expertise in the subsequently perform a selective termination of pregnancy if required. Why a higher level of expertise is required in case of the multiple pregnancy? A higher level of expertise in ultrasound scanning is essential for operators undertaking amniocentesis or chorionic venous sampling in multiple dichorionic pregnancy, because uterine contents have to be mapped with a great care, and this is essential to ensure that separate samples are taken for each fetus and clearly labeled as such. What information should woman be given about the third trimester with amniocentesis? Okay, Women should be informed that third trimester amniocentesis doesn't appear to be associated with significant risk of emergency delivery. And women should be informed that compared with the mid-trimester procedures, complications including multiple attempts and blood-stained fluid are more common in the third trimester procedure. Okay, multiple attempts and blood-stained fluids are more common in the third trimester. Now the question arises, why amniocentesis is indicated in third trimester? Amniocentesis is indicated in third trimester. It is carried on in third trimester for a number of reasons. First of all, late karyotyping. Secondly, detection of suspected fetal infection in pre-labor rupture of membrane. Okay, so if we suspect fetal infection pre-labor rupture of membrane, or if we are going to detect the late karyotyping, we are going to do the late karyotyping for these two indications. Most commonly, amniocentesis indicated in third trimester. But it is also written that most of the literature on the risk of late amniocentesis predates the use of the continuous ultrasound-guided amniocentesis. And more recent series report, more than one attempt in 5% of the sampling and blood loss in 5 to 10% of the cases. Okay, in third trimester, this is the case. This is the figure that there in the pregnancy loss would be more than one attempt or multiple attempt would occur in 5% of cases, and blood stain fluid would be in 5 to 10% of the cases. Okay, the main complications were multiple attempt and blood stain fluid in the third trimester, 5% and 5 to 10%. Now what are the risk of transmission of infection? Okay, it's very important that as we are going to do an invasive procedure, so there are risk of infection transmission. Okay, and how can we avoid it? The ultrasound probe should be enclosed in a sterile bag during any invasive prenatal procedure unless suitably audited processes for probe decontamination and gel microbiological surveillance are in place. Okay, the ultrasound probe should be packed unless we have the other proper decontamination procedures. Secondly, separate sterile gel should be used. Then invasive prenatal procedures should not be carried out without reviewing available bloodborne virus test, screening test. Okay, so when patient comes, proper ultrasound probe should be used, and that should be saved, and proper sterile gel should be used. Secondly, we should also check the reports of the patient, has any bloodborne test, screening test have been performed or not. And then where the woman declines screening for the bloodborne viruses and are being considered for prenatal diagnostic procedure, inform and document the potential risk of vertical transmission of infection to the fetus. Okay, if she refuses that, and if no test have been performed, then we have to inform her and we have to document that there's potential risk of vertical transmission of infection to the fetus. Then review the viral loads and treatment regime prior to invasive prenatal diagnostic testing in the woman with HIV, and consider delaying the procedure until there is no detectable viral load if the woman is already on the treatment. Okay. Then consider antiretroviral therapy prior to invasive procedure in the woman not yet on treatment for HIV. Okay, review viral load. Okay, if a woman is of HIV, and if the woman is not on treatment, we have to consider treatment before starting this procedure. And invasive prenatal testing in the first and second trimester can be carried out in the woman who carry hepatitis B and C. Okay, those women who carry hepatitis B and C, we can carry out invasive procedure. The limitation of the available data should be explained. Okay, we should also explain that there is limitation of the data about hepatitis B and C. As far as HIV, we have already explained that we should check the viral load, and if she's not on treatment, we have to start the treatment. But in case of hepatitis B and C, in the first and second trimester, we can carry out the procedure. But at the same time, we should tell the patient that there is risk, the limitation of the data. And it's written that the risk of severe sepsis is likely to be less than 1 in 1,000 procedure. Okay. And rhesus status. Maternal RHD status should be available or obtained in every case, and prophylaxis with anti-D immunoglobulin should be offered following each procedure in line with the national recommendation. And how should care be organized in providing amniocentesis and CVS? The scope of this guideline is confined to the technical aspect of the two procedure, and for women and her family, good care in these circumstances encompasses more than the simple performance of the technique, and women facing either procedure are usually anxious, and the clinician should bear this in mind, and hospital trust and organization should ensure that equipment, environment, staff training, arrangement for follow-up and the link with the related services carrying out pregnancy termination or support for the woman with the diagnosed chromosomal or genetic disease are of sufficient standard. Thank you so much for your patience. This is all about the guideline of amniocentesis and chorionic villus.